Hey, Nancy Kilpatrick here. I'm the person who wrote Planet of the Beast. I also wrote To the Third Power, two stories in the Jason X novel world. And you're going to hear a reslash of Planet of the Beast. And check it out, because it's a really interesting approach. But before I go, I'm going to tell you a little story about writing Planet of the Beast, which is that my editor at Black Flame Books said to me on the phone, "Now, you know, Jason never leaves anybody alive, and you've got to kill a lot of people. Do you think you'll be able to kill a lot of people in this book?" So I gave him a list, about 200. I think he was a little bit nonplussed, as they say in the UK. And basically, he was good with that. So there you go. Check it out. See if you like this story. And the reading is really well done by Joshua. He's an amazing reader, and I'm so absolutely honored that he reads my books to you guys. So have fun and see you again.
Hello, Slashaholics. This is the 80 Slasher Librarian, Joshua LaRue. Thank you so much for taking the time to listen to my narrations here on the channel. If you want, be sure to follow us on Twitter and Instagram, check out our subreddits, and join our Facebook group page. More information and the links to these social media pages can be found in the description below. Also, on the merch store, we have several great designs, lots of items to choose from, and you'll be helping the channel while walking around in slasher style. But most importantly, check out the Patreon page. This channel cannot be monetized through YouTube, so I depend on slashaholics like you to join up on Patreon for as low as $2 per month to help keep this channel going and growing for years to come. There's several tiers to choose from. You'll be getting stuff like early access to certain content before YouTube, a weekly exclusive podcast called After the Slash, free ebooks, free merch, voice characters, audiobook narrations every month, and so much more. You'll find links to the merch store and Patreon in the description below. Tonight's narration and all content on this channel is brought to you by the patrons of the 80 Slasher Librarian. That's Sean McAllister, Michael Clark, Jake Cutemaker, Tony DeVore, Sim Minoli, Tyrone Kennard, Nick Velkov, Jeffrey Quick, Daniel Mackey, David Arnold, Alex Vanover, Krista Campbell, Rob Davey, Jay Gardner, Willow Ravenwood, Lauren Vaught, Kristen Kay, Michael, William Schaefer, Liam Anderson, Bonanza Jellybean, Bree, Ryan Woodward, Allison Seib, Iron Alexa, Hawaii, Cecilia Spears, Sean Campbell, Catherine McClear, and Carl Eakins. Thank you all so much for supporting the channel. I couldn't do it without you.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Jason X, Planet of the Beast, Chapter 1. "I've got one," the dark-haired, dark-eyed Bella Morte screamed. Real name, Bella Morrison. Ace lab techie. Ancestry on the original Earth from Leon's.
"Nah, you know what? I can do better than that. It's time to reslash this one. Jason X, Planet of the Beast, by Nancy Kilpatrick. Chapter 1.
"I've got one! I've got one!" the dark-haired, dark-eyed Bella Morte screamed. Real name, Bella Morrison. Ace lab techie, ancestry on the original Earth from Lyons, not the one in France, but a tiny town in Kansas. A little mystery never hurt a girl, London Jefferson thought, and besides, the self-inflicted nickname with accompanying spooky makeup and hairstyle was so far from Bella's cheery personality that it was too funny. "I'm frightened already," Brandy said deadpan. All business as usual. The doctor pulled the heart monitor from her pocket, no doubt prepared to get back to her surgery and use her time more productively. "Go for it, grim girl," London egged Bella on. "We could all use another creepy bedtime story." G7's highly specialized crew members relaxed around the solar panels of the common room, a science lab's version of a campfire. This had become a weekly ritual that began with each crew member trying to best the others by relating tales of insanity and violence. Initially, any macabre story was welcomed,
London and told her own unnerving Sasquatch legend from New Saskatchewan, so named after the original Saskatchewan on the original Earth. It was the flattest and driest of corners on Earth, too, where she had been born and lived enough of her life that she knew she wanted out. The Sasquatch was a kind of prehistoric giant that roamed the Rocky Mountains on the original Earth. There were sightings here and there, but nobody had ever seen enough of him to verify that he actually existed. On other parts of that planet, they called him Bigfoot, and his footprints gave him away. London's story was well received, although no one thought that the Sasquatch was particularly scary. And once Bella Morte began regaling them with the adventures of the legendary slicer and dicer Jason, who had terrorized the original Earth, that's all anybody wanted to hear. Especially now, 2 weeks after what had happened with the revival. It was as if the details of those stories substituted for the missing details of reality, and they needed something to soften the blow. There were the usual half-hearted grumblings around the room about unfinished work, about personnel logs to send, and, yeah, London thought, we all know this is silly kid stuff, since Jason was, after all, just a grisly fantasy from the old Earth. But when you're stuck in deep space, orbiting a dreary dark planet at the edge of the Milky Way that is so bleak it doesn't even have a name for God's sake, just a number, 666, what everybody had taken to calling the planet of the beast, when you're so far away from your dearly missed blue and green and brown Earth too, and everyone and everything that is familiar and sustains you, and when you're surrounded by a crew that, until 6 months ago, you hadn't even known existed, any diversion would do. And the Jason stories, which Bella told so well and illustrated with holograms, were better than most to get the blood circulating. Beats a session on the treadmill, London thought. She laughed into Andre, DNA specialist, who had joined the crew of mainly scientists at the last minute for this 5-year mission. Tall, slim, black hair that contrasted with her blonde, very nice clear hazel eyes with flecks of green that matched the green of her eyes. A great solid butt, he was the kind of guy she would have been attracted to anyway, but here on G7 they quickly managed to form more than a friendship. Andre was a good guy, decent, fun, intelligent, sexy. She just wished he had a bit more orientation towards a future that involved the two of them together. Whenever she brought up the subject, he managed to brush her off, and after a while, it seemed intentional. London didn't mind, for now. But he felt like mate-for-life material, and if he didn't want to go that way, she wanted to know sooner than later, so she could adjust her emotions. Her goals included fascinating work, a spouse she loved and who loved her back, and children. 28 wasn't old, but it wasn't young. Her own mother had almost missed the boat, as she said, and London was born later in her life, a move her mother says she did not regret, but London had always had a few doubts about that. Andre slipped his arm around London's shoulders, and she nestled closer to listen, as Bella Morte's chilling tale got underway. Okay, guys, picture this. Planet Earth, before it became too contaminated to support life. Mist clings to the Spanish moss draped from the branches of the ancient oak trees surrounding the northern Louisiana swamp, hiding, it seems, something abominable.
Not another swamp story, Helmut Schmidt, G7's second in command of security, slapped his hands on top of his bald, tattooed head and groaned in a deep and dramatic manner.
Shush, Akiko snapped. To look at her, you'd never think this petite, zen-like flora specialist could defend herself, let alone enter attack mode in a nanosecond. But there you go, looks are deceiving. London had watched this 23-year-old on more than one occasion dominate someone twice her stature. And in fact, Helmut, who suddenly sat back to listen attentively, was twice her size. Akiko had a few anger management issues, but London figured they all did after half a year of forced confinement. The good-natured Bella Morte resumed her tale, her voice dropping as she instructed the computer.
Illumination 50%, please. The lighting dimmed immediately. Holograph Jason number 27 on. Authorization, Bella Morte.
The room lit with the three-dimensional simulation of old Earth,
Louisiana swampland that illustrated the opening of the story as Bella Morte spoke the words.
"Well done, Bella," London said. She smiled and resumed her tale. "One night, when the moon seemed deflated, and enough of the gas molecules that formed the air had turned to liquid molecules, a percentage that went way beyond normal humidity in Louisiana, a sound reverberated through the deathly still night. The living felt as if an earthquake had struck, but there were no quakes in this land of low water tables, devoid of mountains and awash in swampland."
The soldiers at nearby Fort Polk heard it, good men and women, trained as specialists in the art of high-tech killing. They say objects crashed to the ground, barracks shook on their shallow foundations, the soil underfoot trembled, and when the soldiers looked up, falling stars littered the sky as if doomsday had finally arrived. A sergeant and five privates were sent to the nearby swamp to investigate. As they headed out, the base commander overheard this conversation.
"Listen up, y'all. It's Jason." Private Simon, a local boy signed up for service the second he hit 18,
had never once in his life tolerated being called Simple Simon. He possessed an authoritative voice that the others listened to.
"You don't know that,"
Wiley, the timid, pixie-ish private second class, said.
"Yeah, I do, sweetie. Back in Virginia, my first cousin Elmer, he told me about it."
"Man, Jason is just a story." That was D.H. Lawrence, an African-American from Philadelphia, so named by his librarian mother after her favorite author.
"Y'all believe what you want, but all the signs is right," Simon said, relacing one boot tightly.
"Fuck, man, Jason can't be stopped." Phillips, personal fan of Simon, interjected a statement that he saw prove the existence of the cold-blooded serial killer Jason. Where he'd heard this, he didn't know, but it rang true.
"Jason's a killing machine, that's a fact, and we're heading out to meet our maker." Simon spit into the grass.
"This is such bullshit," Wiley snapped.
In a flash, Simon whipped out the Bowie knife he carried inside his boot and threw it from the blade end at Wiley. It landed in the grass close to her feet. Startled, she stared down at the knife. A deadly coral snake, or a fake coral, she still couldn't tell the difference, lay pinned to the earth by the knife blade, just inches from her left foot.
Thanks,
she stuttered. Simon grabbed up his knife, wiped the blade on his pant leg, and slipped it back inside his boot.
"Yep, heading to meet our maker." "Can it, soldiers?" Sergeant Esposito roared. "No more girly talk. This is the U.S. Army, a man's army. Machismo, got it? Whoever or whatever enemy alien we encounter, we can and will take him, her, or it out. Is that understood?"
Yes, Sergeant,
the five soldiers shouted as a well-trained unit. As the base commander watched from headquarters, Esposito marched his small band of soldiers past the white clapboard barracks lined up like pencils by an obsessive organizer, out through the main gate and along the dirt road that led to the paved two-lane. The highway was normally empty, but for army jeeps and convoys of trucks carrying personnel and supplies, especially at this hour. And this evening proved no exception.
"Halt!"
Esposito ordered. The soldiers came to a stop.
"Fall out!"
They now proceeded at their own pace along the blacktop. Wiley and D.H. Lawrence both looked up and understood that the other was also aware of the sky darkening and the rising moon.
"Look at that, will ya?" said D.H. Lawrence. "A harvest moon!"
"It's June!"
Alicia Wiley stared at the blood-red ball in the sky. In her head, she knew that red dust particles in the atmosphere were responsible for the color. So then, why did her heart go arrhythmic?
"What the fuck?"
Phillips gawked at the red globe hanging ominously above them.
"That's our blood," Simon assured them all.
"Put a stopper in it before I do,"
Sergeant Esposito snarled, and the group fell silent. In fact, silence took over the land. Nothing moved, nothing breathed, just the six humans trudging through almost unbearable heat that weighed them down and squeezed sweat from their pores.
Halt!
Esposito, a stickler for protocol, ordered, raising his right hand. He used the beam of his non-army issue pinlight to read the communique from the base commander, which included a small map.
Here's where we turn. The epicenter is in there.
He pointed the pinlight into the gloom of the black swamp. Trees, mostly willows, bent low, their leaves touching the rank water that, had there been light, the soldiers would have seen was covered with puke green moss. They all knew the swamp bred life of every kind, most of it dangerous to humans, especially the swarms of mosquitoes, many of which carried the West Nile virus. Mosquitoes they encountered right now as they headed into the blackness. Each soldier slipped mosquito netting over his or her head as they proceeded, and sprang bug spray on exposed skin. The small platoon headed into the water. The low water table allowed for little soil and water seeped up everywhere around them even before they stepped down into the swamp. When they did, they were knee-high in muck, at least the men. Alicia Wiley was thigh-high.
Keep your eyes open, ladies, the Sergeant Esposito said.
What the fuck?
Phillips cried, swatting his hand. He flicked away the big blood sucker.
Better don some gloves, soldier, Sergeant Esposito told him, in a tone that sounded like an order.
They waded through the stinky water in silence, but for the buzzing of the tiny flying vampires. Once in a while, a smack and a curse rang out as one of the soldiers slapped at a bug that had managed to penetrate the army fatigues.
Wally, you're point man,
he told the diminutive private, who had enlisted for the college benefits but now had second thoughts about this career strategy.
Yes, sir.
She headed out in advance of the mini platoon, arms shoulder high, holding her M16 rifle with both hands and her high-powered flashlight as well, even though most of the light was eaten by the darkness. Every tree looked sinister to her, every patch of moss a cover for a gator or some other predator. She reached down and patted her hip holster and the Beretta 9mm just to reassure herself, hoping she didn't sink and get the handgun wet. Is this why she joined the U.S. Army? To walk crotch deep in water that reeked of decaying things? In pitch darkness? Was this a career? What had she been thinking? Wiley stopped moving for a moment and listened. Not even crickets, nothing. That wasn't right. And already she was so far in advance that she could barely hear the water splashing around the men behind her as they walked. Nothing to report yet, so no need to radio in. The remainder of the platoon trudged through the swamp at a decent clip, considering the environment. D.H. Lawrence, who had always been a studious type, adjusted his wire-rimmed glasses as he fell back to examine a tree so distorted that it resembled a huge hockey player. He'd always loved hockey, especially the Flyers, his home team back in Philly. Something about the smooth movement on ice. He himself was not a graceful man, tripping over his own feet more often than not, preferring to read books rather than work out. Still, he could admire physical activity, the grace and beauty, and the skill of a sport well done. While the little band moved out of earshot, Lawrence approached the tree, hoping to examine it close up, maybe use it someday in a book he might write. But as he neared, the tree seemed to move. No wind he could discern. The light in his flash flickered and then dimmed. Damn! He'd forgotten to change the batteries again. Why was he so out of touch with concrete reality? He looked at the tree with regret. In the dim light, it sure did resemble a man. A huge man. Must be 8 feet tall to the top where the tree just stopped and rounded off. Kind of like a head. It made him think of the top of a hockey mask, and he chuckled to himself. Reluctantly, he started to turn to rejoin the others. He had not even gotten his back to the tree when something cut into his shoulder. So deep he felt it penetrate all the way through. In the darkness, stunned, he looked down but could see nothing. Gingerly, he touched the spot at the front of his shoulder where it was beginning to hurt, and hurt real bad. Something sharp protruded, shaped like a hockey stick blade, but sharp enough that he cut his hand on the tip right through the glove he wore, and then it was gone. Lawrence rested his hand on his shoulder and felt wetness through the cut in the glove. He looked behind him. The tree was gone. When he turned back, it stood before him, hulking, stalking. He opened his mouth to scream, and a branch sliced out, a metal branch like a hockey stick, the blade of which glinted moonlight. It moved so fast he couldn't see where it struck, could not feel a thing. A referee in his head yelled, "Body check, illegal!" He blinked once, twice. Where had the blade struck him? Why did he feel nothing? Through his narrow spectacles, he looked down to watch himself drop into the water. Not all of him, though. In his last moments of silent consciousness, he saw his body just before immersion. In that instant, he knew that he was no longer attached to it.
"Hold up," Sergeant Esposito said. He used his heavy-duty flashlight, waving the beam through the gloom. "Where's Lawrence?" he asked. The other three looked at one another and around them.
"He was right behind me, sir," Philip said, looking a bit frightened in the eerie light. Esposito knew that facing fear was superior to ducking it.
"Phillips, head back and find Lawrence. Here."
He tossed Phillips one of the three walkie-talkies. Esposito kept one and Wiley had the other.
"Radio when you find that son of a bitch and get your asses up here with the rest of us."
"Yes, sir," Phillips said, relishing the importance of the task, dreading being off on his own.
"Simon, you're with me," Esposito said.
"Yes, sir," and he then muttered, "to our doom."
"What was that, Private?"
Nothing important, sir."
"Then keep your trap shut. We don't want to draw any predators our way."
Phillips turned and sloshed through the water, making enough noise to alert every predator north of Baton Rouge to his whereabouts.
"Lawrence," he called softly, then stopped to listen. "DH, where in the hell are you, man?"
Nothing, nothing at all. Just the damn mosquitoes buzzing everywhere, like flies around a corpse. This was a fool's mission, he knew, trudging through swampland in the dark. Why the hell can't the army wait for morning like a normal person? Some light would help. It's not like anybody was in danger from whatever in hell they saw on their damned radar, or sonar, or whatever the fuck type of technology it was that told them that this stupid swamp was the source of the disturbance. His light picked up something round bobbing in the water.
What the fuck?
Suddenly, he saw something slash out. The round thing, what he now recognized as D.H. Lawrence's head, was sailing up out of the water straight towards the middle of two trees. It cleared them right in the middle, like the damned hockey puck between the goalposts that Lawrence went on and on about. As Philip watched this, he did four things simultaneously, in this order. When he saw Lawrence's head spinning over and over on itself as it flew through the air, he gasped. At the same moment, he pressed the button on his walkie-talkie to call for help, and also pulled his 9mm from its holster. The fourth thing he did was his last, and that was really an action which he did not initiate. Phillips saw a giant, and before he could register more, a blade came down onto his head and severed it in two, from the top to the neck. His vision went wonky, pain soared through him. Suddenly, his entire body went sailing up through the air, bashing into tree limbs. The wound sliced his brain in two down the corpse's colossum, disconnecting forever the right and left hemispheres, leaving him unable to put together a cohesive thought, let alone get the safety off the gun and fire it. But as he crashed into one final tree limb that staked him through the intestines, a mini thought did form for Phillips, and dissipate within the split second before he was no more.
What the fuck?
Sergeant Esposito and Private Simon heard Phillips' last gasp over the walkie-talkie.
"Report in, Private Phillips, over,"
the sergeant was saying for the fifth time. Nothing came back at him but dead air.
"What now, sir?" Simon said. "We go back and rescue him too, or push on?"
Esposito glared at the underling, who always managed to irritate him with that know-it-all tone to his voice.
They're big boys, Private. They can take care of themselves. They've got sidearm and M16s, and if they were attacked by gators, we'd have heard shots. If they had time to pull their firepower.
Sir?
Simon addressed his commanding officer as an afterthought deliberately. He didn't respect Esposito. He only respected commissioned officers, where he was headed himself, with no stop at the non-com level. He'd already applied for officer training school. He didn't intend to be a grunt all his life, and the stagnant water around him began to ripple.
Phillips, Esposito said. That you?
He paused.
Speak up, soldier.
Ain't him, Simon said, dropping the address and pulling his sidearm.
It's Jason.
As if in response, trees began falling all around them, their trunks snapping as if they were branches. A dark, hulking form emerged from the greater darkness, and Esposito aimed his powerful beam at the figure, while he jerked his M16 waist high. A man, a giant of a man wearing a hockey mask. Could that be? It must be. His upper arms were dressed like some farm boy, a hick, a rejected hillbilly. He stood motionless, the light picking up a spark of something from eyes as lightless as any dead man's.
Halt! Esposito ordered. Identify yourself!
For a moment, all three of them paused, just long enough to take a breath. Finally, Simon exhaled.
It's Jason! I knew it!
Your weapons at the ready, Esposito ordered his underling calmly, and Simon snapped the safety off his Beretta and lifted it to join his M16 at chest level.
This is Staff Sergeant Esposito of the United States Army. Identify yourself!
The order was barked out into the night. The silence that followed felt far from empty. Suddenly, the huge figure charged. Jason crashed toward them like a powerful linebacker on methamphetamines. A volley of gunfire rang out, round after round. Esposito changed clips in the M16, then Simon did the same. Jason jolted from hit after hit, but kept coming. He was about to streamroller over them.
Right flank him!
Esposito yelled, and Simon started to move to the right, while Esposito went left. They might not have bothered. Jason stretched out his arms crucifixion style and grabbed both at the waist with vice-like hands. Simon's body doubled over and Esposito stretched backwards, two different reactions to the same type of assault. Gunfire lit the sky as more rounds were fired willy-nilly. But before they could react in any other way, Jason tossed both men up into the air. Then he pulled a massive machete from his waistband. As the two men fell, Jason severed the right arm of one and the left of the other, then a leg of each. Limbs dropped and sliced arteries spurted blood in every direction. Two men who, until those moments, had never had much in common. Now they died within seconds of one another, and Jason left their bloody bodies to sink into the swamp in his wake as he stomped forward to hunt down the fifth member of the ill-fated platoon. Wiley had heard it all on her small walkie-talkie, eyes wide in terror. She stood in the hot swamp as if frozen, unable to decide what to do. She had called in during the heat of it, knowing there would be no response until the fight was over. Believing that the response would surely come from Esposito, she waited. And waited. Nothing but static. Which told her everything she needed to know. Heart pounding. Her legs seemed stuck in quicksand, because they had no clear direction from her. She couldn't go back there even to find out what happened to her buddies. Not now, not with unknown danger waiting. And if Esposito couldn't take whoever out, how could she hope to? Could the entire fire team be dead? She couldn't let herself go there. But forging ahead was moving further into the swamp, and that made her more vulnerable. She'd only been down here 2 weeks. She didn't know this terrain. A quick glance at her compass told her that the base was south, to the right of her. But memory said the length of the swamp moved that way, and it would be a long slog home. What to do? The decision was taken out of her hands in an instant too quick to recount. Had she been able to recount it, pain shot through her calf, at least the part that was left. The alligator, head above the surface, almost a smile on its reptilian face, had the partial limb clamped in its maw. That part of her body was missing, and in the mouth of a giant lizard, only registered when she saw her booted foot dangling from in its hinged jaw. Her scream was delayed, and so was Jason, but he caught up to the human being writhing in pain, blood gushing from her thigh above the knee. Blood he could smell even before he saw her. When Wiley saw Jason coming, she reached out a hand for help, until he got close enough for her to see his face, his mask. Then she stopped, pale in the intermittent moonlight, as clouds now streaked what had been a clear sky, moonlight that could barely penetrate the swampland. She waited so patiently for her death that he became eager to give it to her, and did. Jason kicked her in the kneecap, breaking it, and with her only leg now useless, Wiley fell into the swamp face first. Jason could have let her drown on her own, but she thrashed so hard, and life beat so strongly in her that instinctively he pushed her under the water, feeling her flailing, her body jerking and fighting for air, for life, until he fought no more, and she was still. All the while, the gator with Wiley's leg still in its mouth stayed back, off to the side, watching. Locking eyes with Jason, recognizing a cold-blooded predator when it saw one. The base commander would remember the conversation of the fragmented fireteam before they left the base. He'd remember it long after the sun rose, past the hours he had viewed what the new detachment he'd led found when they searched for Staff Sergeant Esposito and his four soldiers. Over 20 body parts were strewn everywhere, floating in the smelly swampy water, caught in the thick Spanish moss hanging from the trees, limbs ripped from torsos, skin shredded, bone crushed, faces unrecognizable, eyeballs and tongues and teeth everywhere like grotesque candies, with the finger of one hand pointing as if to say, he went that away, and the blood. He would always remember the blood, not so much the sight of it, coating torsos and felled trees, but more the odor mixed with swamp sewage, and for no reason at all, in the middle of many nights, he'd awaken to find himself crying silent tears and wondering how God Almighty could allow such an atrocity to be committed. Everyone in the room was silent. Suddenly, London clapped and Andre joined in, but they were the only two of the cynical group to do so. Akiko was the first to try to debunk the story. Okay, so why did they go into the swamp at night? I mean, if they had any sense, like Wiley said, they'd have waited for daylight. Were they stupid or what? Well, they were soldiers, Bellamorte said, and had to follow orders? So their bosses were stupid, and they were too stupid to act on their own initiative, and they don't sound like they put up much of a fight anyway. Jason is as strong as 10 people, and he knows how to sneak up on you, even when he's in full view. That's why he's so dangerous.
Where did he get the blade? Helmet wanted to know.
What blade?
He cut them with a big knife. Did he bring it along?
Bellamorte's eyebrows lifted. Jason always carries a machete. That's part of who he is. I told you that in the last installment.
Right, but a guy that big would make some noise. An alligator? Andre cut in, laughing. That's pretty cheap.
London then added, getting into the spirit of it, if they'd analyzed their data better, they would have known there was a human being in the swamp. I mean, it's unclear what these soldiers were looking for anyway. Something fell from the sky? A seismic occurrence? What? But they just got computers at the end of the 20th century, Bellamorte insisted. They probably did the best they could with the limited amount of data they had. And besides, computers were much slower then.
Renata Henderson, head of the lab security, shook her hairless head once in the negative.
Those M16s were primitive. That's for sure. A friend of mine collects antique guns and let me fire his once. They have quite a kick by today's laser standards, and you had to keep reloading the magazine. Did you know they run on bullets? A stupid blend of gunpowder being forced from a cylinder? But primitive or not, they should have taken this Jason guy out. Unless he was bionic.
I could have taken him with my bare hands, Helmet said, jumping to his feet, assuming a fighter's stance. No way would he get by me.
Yeah, sure. Renato reached up and punched his thigh in the good-natured way of bodybuilding types. Maybe if you had me for backup.
Backup? Huh! Wouldn't need it.
Well, who's head of security?
You. But that's just because I got that demerit on my record, or I'd be...
That's the thing, Bellamorte interrupted. Jason can never be killed. He's eternal. No matter what anybody ever did to him. He always survived it. He's immortal. Immortal? He wouldn't survive space, that's for sure. Renata sneered, standing and stretching, showing off rippling muscles in her chest and shoulders through her t-shirt, while Helmet looked on with grudging admiration. Basically, she wanted them to see why she was head of security. And Helmet did. The woman worked out 6 times a day, twice as often and 3 times as long as he did. And the work showed on her body. He hated to admit it, and never would verbally, but he was lazy, and she was pretty good, maybe his equal. Nah, he couldn't entertain such stupid thoughts. No woman could best a man for muscle development. He was about to open his mouth and say something witty when Renata said, Well, it's just a story, so you can tell it any way you like. In reality, there's no Jason, and even if there was, our modern laser weapons would take him out instantly. Bellamorte then began, I'm not so sure.
This is how you people waste your time, Claude Bardot snapped. And some of you are scientists and should know better.
The prematurely graying boss of the science lab stood in the doorway, his tall, average-weight body seeming to take up a lot of space, likely from tension. All eyes were drawn, as usual, to his prosthetic arm, made up defiantly, as if to draw attention to the fact that his body had rejected innumerable cloned arms. And if he was going to be stuck with a fake limb, he wanted a metallic limb, not some cheap imitation of flesh. No one knew if he'd heard any or all of the story, but everyone understood that Bardot held an opinion on everything, and that no matter what any of them said or did, they all fell about a mile short of his approval, which meant none tried to live up to his standards. None but his sidekick, Emery Peterson, who stood beside Bardot. An annoyingly and unjustifiably satisfied look on his face, as if Daddy had just spanked the siblings. Before Bellamorte could say it, the head geneticist commanded.
Lights up!
Instantly, the hollow images were vanquished by white light that made everyone blink madly until their eyes could adjust. Bardot bent his 40-year-old body forward around the doorframe, reminding London of a flexible praying mantis. He peered instantly at each of them, recording in his computer-like brain exactly who was there, enjoying themselves, wasting time, as he put it. The small bald spots at the top of his head glowed in the bright light like a shiny egg, and London swallowed a laugh at this silly image.
While you're all in here telling childish stories, I am forced to halt my research,
London, suddenly furious, said in a low voice. What we do on our own personal downtime is our own business. He only glanced at her and then turned to Renata.
I require a shuttle immediately. I must go to planet 666 as soon as possible.
Now? Renata glanced at her watch. It's the middle of the night.
Night is irrelevant in space, came the reedy voice of Bardot's assistant, who stepped out into the light from behind his boss and his idol.
Round-eyed, brown-eyed, bespectacled Emery Peterson, of a fragile and awkward physical nature and a simpy personality, worshipped Bardot's brilliant mind.
Basking in the big kahuna's radiance meant that one day the 25-year-old, too, would be wealthy and famous beyond his wildest dreams, even though he could never emulate what Bardo had and would still accomplish in the field of genetic mutation. Bardo had already let Emery sign his name to a lesser academic paper that focused on this very subject of time in relation to genetics. Despite most of the crew insinuating that he was a yes man, Emery felt he was his own person. They couldn't seem to understand that Bardo was such a genius that there was never a need to dispute him. "Time and space," Emery continued, pulling himself up to his full 5 feet 5 inches, "becomes limited to human biases about light and dark and..." "Can it, Emery?" Akiko snapped, getting to her feet. "Nobody here needs a lesson about time and space, especially from you." Andre stood too.
"I'm headed to bed. Coming?" he asked London.
She got to her feet as well and took his hand, and together they left the room by the emergency exit door opposite the main door where Bardo stood. They were quickly followed by Bellamorte, Akiko, and Helmet, who all preferred to exit that way than pass too close to Professor Claude Bardo. As Renata started out the main door, which Bardo had taken possession of, he demanded,
"I need a shuttle. Immediately. You will accompany me to the docking bay."
Renata stopped dead and rotated her shaved, tattooed head slowly in his direction, fixing him with piercing hazel eyes. Bardo couldn't help but see the muscles in her neck grow taut.
"Well, that's not my department, is it, Bardo? You'll have to wake Felicity. In case you've forgotten, there are only 2 crew members authorized to drive the shuttles, unless it's an emergency. And I don't see this as an emergency. The other authorized pilot, in case you've forgotten that too, is Bill. He's also sleeping. Despite the relativity of time and space, that's where I'm headed to sleep. Unless you've got any other questions about who does what on this station."
"Your sarcasm is poorly phrased and unappreciated," Bardo began, but Renata disappeared out the door and he was left alone with Emery.
"What a cretin!"
Emery yelled, but not quite loud enough for Renata to hear him, or at least he hoped not.
"What will we do, Claude?"
the younger man said, in a voice that showed how ineffective he felt when doors slammed in his face. Bardo, who hated anyone using his first name, scowled at his assistant.
"Go wake Felicity. We've got to get to planet 666 now. The body of Jason X is there. I'm sure of it. That's where he's crashed. We must find him before anyone else encounters his remains. And well before a search party is sent out for the missing crew of the revival."
He paused for effect, the silence binding Emery to him as if the younger man were tethered by a rope.
"Jason X will be my greatest experiment."
"Yes," Emery said.
"My finest work. My piece de resistance."
"The world will bow at your feet."
"I will change the world of genetics in ways no one else can even imagine."
"You're a genius, sir, a mind dazzling as a sun with twice the power, unique, one of a kind. Mankind, common and simple as it is lucky to have you to lead the way."
"Indeed," Bardo said, accepting the praise as his due. "The wretched masses shall develop in a manner they had not hitherto anticipated, and be the better for it."
His self-satisfied look lasted a moment or two. Then he looked down at his fan club of one and commanded,
"What are you waiting for? Go, quickly! Wake the pilot! There's no time to lose!"
Emery took off in the direction of the sleeping quarters for the non-science crew, filled with the fire of a mission. Bardo, knowing the clout he held, felt assured the pilot would complain but would be dressed and ready in short order. He exited the room and took the elevator in the hallway down from deck number 2 to deck number 4, then walked the short hallway to the elevator that descended from the station via cables down to the shuttle bay.
That deck had been designed to be separate from the main station, for safety purposes. All the better, Bardo thought, for one never knew what precious items one might discover and bring back from a planet.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 1 of the ReSlashed edition of Jason X, Planet of the Beast, Jason X Part 3, by Nancy Kilpatrick. And I gotta say, I really enjoyed, just like I did the first time I narrated it, but redoing this, it was really awesome to go back through that story that Bellamorte is telling the crewmates on the ship. You know, it's just so fun the way these people, like 600 years in the future, the stories of Jason have been passed down over generation to generation, and it gets to this point where she's like telling the story about like this 9-foot guy who's a hockey player and he kills people with a hockey stick. It's just funny how like Nancy wrote it to where like the story has been passed down and changed generation to generation to, you know, it's just some wild freaking story now. And I like the irony that, you know, she's sitting here telling this story and her crewmates are on there saying, yeah, well, I'd fuck Jason up, or I wouldn't need backup and all that. And unbeknownst to them, they're about to, you know, encounter Uber Jason, after the events of Jason X. So not only are they going to get their chance to go up against Jason and back those words up, but they're going up against, like, a Super Jason at this point, especially after the events of the experiment where he was made even more powerful. We also got introduced to two of my favorite characters from this book that I hope you guys will enjoy too. I kind of refer to them as like Pinky in the Brain, and that's Bardo and Emery. Bardo is like this over, I don't even know what the word for it is. He's just so full of himself. He gets his mind on his task, and this is the kind of guy that would become a mad scientist and try to take over the world. So he's like the brain. And then he's got his little sidekick scientist, Emery, kissing his ass constantly. You don't know where one begins and the other one ends because he's got his head so far up Bardo's ass. And he's kind of stupid. I mean, he's a scientist, so obviously he's smart, but he lacks common sense. All he does is just back up Bardo and kiss his ass and talk about him and do whatever he says. He's his little toady. And, you know, I'm really excited about diving back into this book. This chapter here reminded me what I loved about this book so much. It's like the movie Jason X. It's a lot of fun, it's fresh, it's original, it does not take itself seriously, or too seriously at that. It has fun with the story, and therefore makes it fun to read and experience, and I hope you guys are all enjoying it as well. I'll be back next week with another ReSlash chapter or two of Jason X, Planet of the Beast. Some exciting stuff coming up in the story. Bardo and Emery are going to head to the Planet of the Beast and try to find Jason's body after the revival had crashed. And yeah, there's some very interesting stuff coming up in the story, and I hope you enjoy it. And I know some people are going to question about Jason running, Jason being called Jason X, and stuff like that. That was like an in-joke by Nancy when she was writing the book. But yeah, you know, it's... like I said, Jason has been, the story of him has been passed on and passed on and passed on, and so I can see people getting his name wrong and stuff like that in the future. You know, I mean, Jason X was the title of the book, that's never what Jason's name was, but I can forgive that because the story is so good, it's a lot of fun. So yeah, you know, I can look past that and just have fun with the story for what it is. Nancy has written a very fun Jason X book here. We're only one chapter into it, we got the prologue and chapter one out of the way. And from here, the story really takes off, so strap in. I'll see you next week with another installment. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian, saying thanks for listening, be excellent to each other, and I'll see you next week.
you are the healer, means I'm broken and lame. If thine is the glory, then mine must be the shame. You want it darker. We kill the flame. Magnified, sanctified be thy holy name. Vilified, crucified in the human frame. A million candles burning for the help that never came. You want it darker. I'm ready, my lord. There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker. We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker?
Hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Hail to the king, baby.
Great Scott.
Doc. If you are the dealer, let me out of the game. If you are the healer, if that's the glory, mine must be the shame. You want it darker.
Buckle up, bonehead, because you're going for a ride.
Hey,